Vasectomy is a minimally invasive procedure and an excellent form of birth control for couples. Some men are often reluctant to pull the trigger on getting snipped, so to speak. There are a lot of myths floating around about vasectomy, and some of this reluctance stems from these common myths. Hello, it's Dr. Garrett Pullman, host of the Prostate Health Podcast. We have Dr. Jay Sandlow joining us today to help debunk 10 of the more common vasectomy myths. So stay tuned. So the big question is this: how can men and those who care for them better educate themselves regarding prostate health, the conditions that affect the prostate, and the latest technology in managing these conditions? That is the question, and this podcast will provide the answers. On a weekly basis, we will be chatting with experts, innovators, and leaders in the field of urology, sharing useful information with the general public to improve their lives and increase their overall health. My name is Dr. Garrett Pullman, and welcome to the Prostate Health Podcast. Prostate Health Podcast is for informational purposes only. Nothing in this podcast should be construed as medical advice. By listening to the podcast, no physician-patient relationship has been formed. For more information and counseling, you must contact your personal physician or urologist with questions about your unique situation. We are excited to have joining us today on the Prostate Health Podcast, board-certified urologist Dr. Jay Sandlow. He is a fellowship-trained specialist in male infertility and completed his urology residency and fellowship at the University of Iowa. Currently serves as vice chair and professor for the Department of Urology at the Medical College of Wisconsin in Milwaukee. He is experienced in microsurgery as well as minimally invasive treatments for male contraception. He was a member of the Vasectomy Guidelines Task Force, as well as serving on the current group updating the guidelines. He has also taught the AUA vasectomy course for the last 7 years, as well as completing 2 vasectomy missions in the Philippines. Dr. Sandlow, welcome to the Prostate Health Podcast.
Thanks, Garrett. I'm really happy to be here.
So, Dr. Sandlow, you have performed approximately 7,000 vasectomies in your career. I know you've undoubtedly heard pretty much all of the major myths about vasectomies over the years, many of which cause potential anxiety for these men considering a vasectomy, maybe even to the point in causing them to hold off on pursuing this option of birth control. I thought it would be helpful if you could help, kind of bust some of the more common myths today.
Sure. Happy to do so.
So one of the first is that having a vasectomy will affect your testosterone level. You get a vasectomy and all of a sudden you're going to get hooked on watching the soap operas, TV shows on Bravo, have hot flashes, low sex drive, and reduced muscle mass.
So it's interesting because that's actually a pretty common myth that a lot of guys worry about. And I think some of it is that they sort of think of vasectomy as, being neutered. So I'm always very careful to explain to patients when I'm counseling them that your testicles don't know you've had a vasectomy. They still work exactly the same. So the hormones that are made are the same. Your pituitary hormones that drive the testicular function, exactly the same. There's lots of great studies that show that testosterone levels don't change with a vasectomy. I specifically mentioned that during my counseling that it will not change their testosterone levels.
So now for the next myth, number 2, I will no longer make sperm after a vasectomy.
So that's a perfect segue. Same thing. Testicles are making sperm and the sperm still go through the whole maturation process. They go through the epididymis, which is the gland that sort of connects the testis to the vas deferens. And then ultimately the sperm sit there. They can't go any further because of the vasectomy. So they die and then the body breaks them down and reabsorbs them. It's one of the reasons that vasectomy reversals can work is that when you reestablish the connection of the two ends of the vas deferens, then the sperm can flow through.
And that kind of ties into the next myth is that I've had some guys, or I've seen this out there that, the sperm will then build up in the test and my testicles will then explode. How about that myth?
Yeah. Again, a lot of the patients will sit there and take this to their logical conclusion that, okay, well, if the sperm are still being made, it's going to back up and eventually my testicles will explode. Because the body figures out a way to reach an equilibrium, there is sperm production that's matched with sperm breakdown and reabsorption. It is interesting to note, though, that there is a condition called epididymal blowout, which sounds way worse than it is. But typically, what happens is as the sperm breakdown products build up and start to back up into the epididymis, it can cause a rupture and a scarring of the epididymal tubule, which causes a second blockage. This is something that is rarely noticeable to the patient, but as somebody who also does vasectomy reversals, it's something that we always have to be aware of because it changes how we do the reversal.
What about vasectomy is the same as castration?
Right. So again, I think we joke about it a lot and say that, you know, you're going to get fixed. And, you know, especially when I was at the University of Iowa and we dealt with a lot of people who worked on farms and they were used to, you know, castrating the hogs. And that's what they thought this was. The testicles are still attached and they still work normally. So as we had mentioned before, they're still making testosterone, they're still making sperm. The sperm just are blocked from getting out of the testicles.
So myth number 5, after a vasectomy, I will no longer have any ejaculate with orgasm.
Again, you know, most patients are not scientists and they don't necessarily know the anatomy. So one of the things I do during my counseling is I show them where semen comes from. The majority of semen comes from the seminal vesicles. That's where most of the fluid is. So when you do a vasectomy, you notice very little decrease in the amount of ejaculate that comes out. The interesting thing though, and I particularly with my older patients, and I guess I should say my patients in their late 40s, early 50s, is I tell them that you may notice a difference because as we age, the amount of our ejaculate goes down, mainly because there's less fluid coming from the seminal vesicles. So proportionately, it will seem as if there's less ejaculate coming out after a vasectomy because that fluid from the testicles will no longer be in the ejaculate.
Now, the next one, number 6, is one that I think is a very important one too to talk about, is one that I often hear is, it is easier for a woman to get her tubes tied.
Yeah. So I think that's a huge myth. There's lots of things about vasectomy that make it superior to a tubal ligation. It's easier, it's quicker, it's less invasive, it's less expensive, and it's actually much more effective. So when we talk about the failure rate of a vasectomy, we say once a vasectomy has been deemed successful, the failure rate is probably somewhere between 1 in 2,000 and 1 in 4,000. The failure rate for most tubals is about 1 in 700. The only time that a tubal might be easier than a vasectomy is if it's done at the same time as a scheduled C-section. And even then, talking to my, you know, OBGYN colleagues, they say that because of all the increased blood flow down there during pregnancy and during delivery, the tubal does have a higher complication rate than normal just because of all the dilated blood vessels. So it's pretty rare that I would say to a couple, it's actually going to be better for the female partner to be sterilized compared to the male.
Now for the next one, I know cannot for number 7 can cause, you know, a lot of anxiety too for men just thinking about that possibility. But again, another myth that I thought we need to debunk is that having a vasectomy will affect the ability to have an erection.
So again, you know, those are the biggest things, right? You know, will I have a problem with erection? Will I have a problem with ejaculation? What about my testosterone levels? As you know, the nerves that control erection are nowhere near the actual testicles. You know, they run over the prostate in the pelvis and go to the penis. So we are nowhere near any of the nerves that control erection or ejaculation for that matter. But again, I think it's very important for people who are doing vasectomies to come out and specifically tell patients these things as opposed to waiting for them to ask, because a lot of times patients are either embarrassed to ask, they don't want to sound, you know, uninformed or stupid to the doctor, but, you know, it's sort of like when I take my car to the mechanic, I have no clue what to ask or what's going on, and I'm really depending on the mechanic to tell me, here are the important things.
Dr. Sandlow, this has been great so far. We're going to take a quick break here, and we'll be right back to finish debunking some more vasectomy myths. Thanks again for joining us today on the Prostate Health Podcast. Now, do you have an upcoming appointment at the urologist's office? Maybe you're scheduled for a biopsy of your prostate, or just received the news that your biopsy was positive for prostate cancer, and now have an upcoming consultation to discuss options with your urologist. You may be wondering, How should I prepare for these appointments, and what should I expect? Well, I've partnered with the Prostate Health Academy to create a free What to Expect guide that will help get you up to speed as you prepare for your visits. This guide includes checklists of what you need to bring and how to prepare. This guide includes what to expect with three different scenarios, including your initial urology clinic appointment, a prostate biopsy, and prostate cancer consultation. To receive this free guide, simply go to www.prostatehealthpodcast.com/clinic. Again, that's www.prostatehealthpodcast.com/clinic, or you can find the link on our podcast website at prostatehealthpodcast.com. So for the next one, I think I've heard it both ways in terms of this myth. For number eight, I've heard a vasectomy can always be reversed, or a vasectomy can never be reversed.
Exactly right. So I always talk to my patients about the fact that while we can reverse them, we do consider them to be permanent. So we acknowledge that life changes. You know, sometimes relationships end and you get a new relationship. Sometimes couples change their mind. God forbid, sometimes you actually have, you know, a couple who loses a child. But you don't go into a vasectomy with the thought that this is going to be something that you're going to use for about 5 or 6 years and then you'll reverse it, because we can't guarantee that that reversal will be technically successful or, more importantly, actually establish a pregnancy. So for those of us that do a lot of reversals, the technical success rate's actually pretty high. I would say overall about 90% of my guys will get sperm back, and that could be well over 95% depending on the type of procedure, but that does not necessarily translate into a pregnancy. And so really, I'm not telling guys that you'll never be able to have this reversed. I don't think you need to do a vasectomy thinking it'll never be reversed. But by the same token, you don't go into it thinking that it's going to be temporary.
So, and then the next one kind of goes along with some of those, the counseling that we do as well. But for number nine, the effects of a vasectomy are immediate.
Again, something that I'm probably tell this to patients multiple times, both during counseling and after the procedure. You're not considered sterile until a sample is dropped off that doesn't show sperm or that shows very rare sperm. So it's not like you get it done on Friday and you're good to go on Saturday. For most men, it takes about 2 to 3 months to clear everything out. There's actually some very good data to show that there is an early failure rate within the first 4 to 6 weeks. And so when we came up with the vasectomy guidelines, we were very careful to say that you should wait at least 8 weeks to even test. One, because for the most part, most guys will still have residual sperm. But two, and more importantly, this early recannulation that can occur in the first month or so would be missed if you tested too early. So I've had guys who have been very dedicated. They've read that about 25 or 30 ejaculates should do it. So they'll, you know, do that in a week or two and drop off their sample. And some of them really have no sperm at that point. And I say, great job. That shows a lot of dedication, but we still need to wait at least 6 to 8 weeks before we test you and clear you, because there is that small chance of early recannulation.
That's a great point. Now, lastly, for number 10, vasectomy causes prostate cancer. I thought for our listeners here on the Prostate Health Podcast, we could just maybe dive a little bit deeper into this one, a concern I see come up from time to time from patients, but also in, you know, even prostate cancer support groups and patients kind of retrospectively looking back and had prostate cancer as well as a vasectomy. So Dr. Sandlow, you are a member of the Vasectomy Guidelines Task Force, as well as on the current guideline group for updating the current guidelines. What is the current American Urology Guideline stance in regard to vasectomy in prostate cancer?
Well, Garrett, that's a great point. A little history, and unfortunately, I'm old enough to remember this history. So back in the early 90s, there were two papers that were published in JAMA, both from the same institution, that basically said that patients who had a vasectomy were 2 times more likely to develop prostate cancer during their lifetime. And it made a big splash in the media for a couple of reasons. First of all, because it was something that really had not been, you know, promoted before. It came out of Harvard, so you know, there's a lot of credibility. Although, interestingly, nobody on the paper was a urologist or even an oncologist. It was all epidemiology. And there were a lot of issues with the methodology of the paper, including the fact that it was a highly screened population because many men who had had vasectomies obviously had been in the healthcare system and therefore were more likely to either get screened for prostate cancer or to show up with symptoms. The other thing was that way even before my time, when men would have transurethral resections of their prostate for an enlarged prostate, and we know that that group automatically is at higher risk for prostate cancer because we would often find it in the tissue that we would remove, they would routinely do a vasectomy at the same time in order to prevent post-op infection. We don't do that anymore. That's probably not even something you ever heard of in your training. And so many of the men who had these resections also had vasectomies, and they're obviously a higher risk group. At that time, the AUA was not doing any kind of guidelines, but some very prominent urologists in the AUA were on an NIH study panel to look at this. And basically, they looked at all the literature and said, there's really no good evidence that this is true. And if you think about it from a biological perspective, we just said having a vasectomy doesn't change your hormone production. It doesn't change your testicular function. Therefore, how would it have any impact on prostate function or the development of prostate cancer? So now fast forward to, I believe it was like 2013 or 2014. So we had put this thing to rest for about 20 years. And then the same group came out with another paper that was published in Oncology that basically said, we've updated our study and we still think that vasectomy is associated with a higher risk of prostate cancer. And again, now at this point, we had our vasectomy guidelines. We had reviewed all of the literature, both pro and con, and had basically determined that, you know, as a urologist, we do not need to counsel our patients that vasectomy infers a greater risk of prostate cancer. So this same group, we reviewed this paper and we had our epidemiologists go over it. And there were a couple of really interesting things that came out of it. One of which is that I think in the 20 years, we found that with epidemiologic studies, when you have a relative risk in a large study like this, where both arms are very common. So prostate cancer is a very common thing. 1 in 9 men get it. And vasectomy is a very common thing. About 500,000 vasectomies are done in a year. Your relative risk, in order to be really significant, needs to be much higher than 2 or 2.5. And so besides the methodology, I think a lot of the conclusions that were made were erroneous. It's a little bit like what we see going on with coffee. Every other day, there's a new study coming out that's either saying coffee is very beneficial or coffee is really bad. And it's because there's so many coffee drinkers, you can link it to almost anything. Same thing with prostate cancer and vasectomy.
Well, thank you for going over that. I think that's very important, especially for our prostate health podcast, to, again, kind of give some background in history regarding that claim. And again, that vasectomy does not cause prostate cancer. So in summary, Dr. Sanlow, you have provided an excellent review in addressing 10 of the more common vasectomy myths, hopefully relieving any reluctance or hesitation some men have on proceeding with scheduling their vasectomy. Dr. Sanlow, any final thoughts for our listeners today?
First of all, thank you so much for this opportunity. As you've probably found out, I could talk about vasectomies for a long time. But I do think that, you know, in the desire to establish a perfect contraceptive, vasectomy is certainly not perfect. I think it is an excellent option, maybe not for everyone, but for many men. And I'm seeing more and more men who are stepping up, basically saying, look, my partner has been the one that's been responsible for birth control. She had to give birth to our children. This is my way of contributing. And I think that the more that we reassure men that vasectomy is safe, it's effective, the better that we can help our patients.
Well, Dr. Sanlow, it was certainly a joy to chat with you today on the Prostate Health Podcast. You've definitely given a lot of valuable information today for our listeners. Thank you again.
Thanks again, Garrett.
Thank you again for listening to the Prostate Health Podcast. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at GPullmanMD. Don't forget to join us next week for another episode. Thank you.